for joining today. So I think our audience, this is the fifth episode that we are doing in our Culture Club episodes, where we are attacking problems around e-culture. And now that the world is working remotely, this we are talking to HRs from leading organizations in India and touching on all the questions that are very important for HRs. And these questions and the answers from HRs themselves would help the entire community and the fraternity solve problems at their organizations. That's the key goal of what we are doing at Culture Monkey as well. So today we have Pranav from Renault Nissan, and Ketan will be hosting this episode. And yeah, back to you, Ketan. We can get started already.
Just a small correction. I am from Renault, no more with Nissan. So I had the HR for Renault there.
All right. So yeah, guys, so the correction as it goes, Pranav's from Renault, and yeah, back to you, Ketan.
So one of the reasons I'm here, I got introduced to Culture Monkey sometime back. We tried it for Rent2Mojo. I really fell in love with the product because of the work that they had done, and especially knowing that this is a bunch of people who have never worked in HR, creating a product like that impressed me. It inspired me. And during the conversation, we realized that we could add value to each other. So I am advising them on a few of the stuff, whatever I've learned in HR, and helping them create a product that can actually solve a problem for what HRs would anticipate in future. So that's about Culture Monkey. That's why I'm here. And for our audience, today I have with me Captain Pranav Prasoon. He heads human resources for Renault India. He's based out of Chennai as of now. Captain, so yeah, with Captain, yes, we know he served the nation, he's been a captain in the Indian Army. He served there for 5 years. And post that, he went to IIM Lucknow. He did his post-graduation from there and then jumped into the corporate world. Started his career with a logistics firm, and then after his stint in the Indian Army, and then he moved to Chennai. Then he joined, I think that time it was Renault Nissan, Pranav, and he's grown within the organization at a very, very fast pace, and almost about 9-10 months back, he was given the mantle to head HR for Renault. So that's Captain for you. He's a marathoner. He's been an author almost 10 years back. So while I became an author recently, and he's been an inspiration for me for sure. But he wrote his first book, The Unknown, quite some time back. I featured into that. There's one part of the story that we know. I was a party to that. He came to my place in Mumbai and something very interesting happened. But a book definitely you guys should catch up. It's about his journey, especially in the Indian Army. A lot of people in the armies are actually fan of that particular book. And he loves talking. He's a motivational speaker. He's actually been there in the field and led it from the front. So
wonderful.
He knows it. Can see him to many campuses. He contributes a lot to help people bring the better version of themselves. So if you go to LinkedIn or social media or otherwise, I think every few days you would see some of his video. Now that video is also because I pushed him to publish video, but he does far more conversations and engagement with people than what is there in the video. Should listen to him sometime. I think if you guys later want somebody to come and inspire and charge up the team and tell you how to see and what challenges of life can somebody see generally in life and the army and then coming to civil, I think he's the go-to guy. So Chennai, once lockdown is over, I think get him to your office and it would
absolutely
be fun to...
Absolutely, yes. Sure.
Yeah, and I think leadership is something that he's very passionate about. A lot of his conversations, I think he's trying to bring the corporate and the experiences from the field right out there and talk to people. And that's okay. I can talk about him almost for 2-3 hours without even speaking, but I'm not going to do that further. And Pranav, welcome again to this e-culture club episode of Culture Monkey. and we are so glad to have you here. I'm sure your insights, your experiences, your perspectives are going to help everybody who's watching this program get a new perspective of the overall concept of culture. How is it evolving? What changes do you see? And towards the end, there are some interesting questions. I'm sure Senthil hasn't sent those to you, but I'm going to end the session with something interesting, few rapid fire questions for you that I have. And I added some interesting perspective to that because maybe I know you personally. So that is going to be a fun part.
Interesting.
So would you like to talk, start with a bit about your organization so that people understand what are we talking about, what kind of setup is there, and what do you take care of? Just a little bit about that, Rona.
Okay, thank you, Ketan. And it is quite emotional. First time when we were together on the stage, we were in our half pants. I don't remember, 7th or 8th. And we were participating for the first time in Extempore, and we both came third, if you remember, Ketan. So what better if your best buddy hosts you and takes the hell out of you. Maybe I am really scared now. You disclose something on the rapid fire, so I'm sweating in my hands. So now fine. About the organization, God had been kind enough. Yes, we had been crossing our ways many times, and currently I head the HR for Renault India. Now Renault India is a commercial entity, and we sell cars. If Renault, Nissan, and Mitsubishi alliance, what we talk about, we as alliance, we make the car together, we engineer the car together, we manufacture the car together, but we sell the car differently. So then Renault and Nissan becomes a different company. I head the HR for Renault India, and majorly the people are from sales and marketing domain. A portion of it also comprises of supply chain, and we sell Renault cars in India. So that's how it is. We are present in almost all the corners of India with our dealership, and the corporate offices are in all the regions. So that's what. And currently I'm in Chennai, but we also have a corporate office in Gurgaon, and I keep on shuffling there sometimes. That's what, if I have to summarize about the organization, that's what I do.
What challenges have you seen, or do you think your CXOs are facing with this COVID impact? Post-COVID, the world seems to be going remote and a lot of things are happening virtually. What are the kind of challenges that you have seen in your conversation? You figure out that the CXOs are talking about and getting through, especially with context of culture and engagement?
Okay, so I'll be quite blunt the way I talk, Ketan. One thing is, I really see the real leadership happening. Okay, as for my experience, what it comes from, Amit. Yes, if you're not clear on your decision making and leadership skills, you might lose people, and India might lose a portion of the land. So similarly, when I see today, if you are not very clear in the decisions which you make or the actions which you do, the entire the sphere of the pandemic can spoil the motivation of the employees. And if the decision makings are not very strong, and if the visions are not very, very clear, you don't know where you will land in the market tomorrow. So where I see today, yes, the focus and the majority what CXOs are doing is complete leadership, leading by examples, which can be a very small thing. When the lockdown was opened, how to ensure that the staff is protected enough, cared enough, and brought to the office, and they should have that confidence to deliver, right? And if now last 100 days we have seen enough changes, many cities things are not very good, and we have to open it, close it, then you have someone who is positive inside the office, how will you operate in such cases? Employees are really scared, the families are scared. Majorly when we see that when the IT says that work from home is an option and they are executing it, but for an organization which is a product-centric organization, where the sales is a concern, point-to-point contact is more important. would you really change the, your entire fashion of working, right? Though various mechanisms are happening and a lot of innovations are happening in different organizations, but everyone is trying to figure out that what is a new normal, or is there any new normal or not. So when I see a lot of confusion, lot of innovation happening, lot of talking happening, and lot of crude core leadership happening in the entire scenario, if I have to sum it.
Oh, excellent. This is very powerful and very direct. What, as per you, is the silver lining? Are you seeing this bringing out, and this is more from, if you're wearing a completely HR hat right now, what do you think this is leading to, which you have always wanted the CXOs or the line or the business to own up, and they were possibly not doing earlier, and they've started doing now with the outbreak of COVID and how the world has changed?
Okay, so it I'll keep it simple. I rather put it like to take chances, to see for a solution which you have never thought of, right? I can give examples here when we talk about sales. For the first time, many OEMs, they have launched that mechanisms for digital sales. Yeah, and first time the customer is buying a car without even doing a test drive, right? And that people started, you know, at, as early as that. And how different mechanism, you know, with the help of, let's say, augmented reality, how you will bring that feeling of it cannot be perceived feeling now. It cannot be with the touch and feel of the car, but how the same thing can be done to create an experience. Yeah. So a lot of companies are doing it. Many people who started it, who were the beginners and the initiators, they did quite well. And during the lockdown, April month, when the entire industrial volume was zero, there were companies who were smiling a little bit and telling that at least I have some digital sales. It's not, the cars is not delivered, but at least the customers are ready for it. And then post the lockdown, when it was a bit relaxed, the complete focus was to translate those digital sales into the physical sales and to see the numbers. So one thing is just taking chances. Had we ever thought about it that a company which is completely selling products doesn't show the product, you know, the experience is not sold to the customer, and still the customer is gained. It was impossible. So such innovations when I see happening. Who was the, when the thing was generally, if you remember, March second week or something, when even the government was not clear what to do, because everyone was feeling and knowing it for the first time. There were different philosophies were coming. Someone were lighting lamps, and someone were, you know, playing with the bells or whatever. And someone was writing a lot of stories that, okay, because of the different positioning of the planets or something has happened and something will go. Someone was telling that it will not happen in India because our temperature is very different and summers are coming, so everything will go. There are a lot of things there. A lot of science was being spoken. God forbid, you know, this is something which is a spinner, which is a sudden thing created by God or howsoever it has come. Can we define it? Can we control it? It is beyond it. But how will you maneuver yourself as a business, as a business continuity planning came into picture very strongly. And we have seen organizations who started working from the first week of March, when the things were, you know, going in bits and pieces, and they happened to be quite strong. And then there were organizations who only closed the company when the directive from the government was given. So if I have to underline, I'll mention the same point that I saw different, you know, innovations happening, different way of thinking happening. People started testing different media. Suddenly digital thing got so much into action, and everyone was on the media, on the social media, and trying to push it. Now things have sedimented in a very different way, but we all tested it for the first time, and I think we are quite okay, comfortable now. Yeah.
And how do you think this is, what does it mean for the HR fraternity? What is it redefining? What parts of HR is it fundamentally redefining as per you?
Oh my God. Now here, if I connect two me's, one is the army me and the current one. a lot of inspiration I get from here, because when the things are fine, you know, it is quite comfortable. You know, you can have all your, you know, psychology principles and Maslow's all laws, and you can inspire and motivate people to get the thing out of it. Now you have a guy who's scared, you know, who doesn't bother that, you know, if today, tomorrow he has a job or not. But today his those lower things are more important. The basic needs, the physical needs, the security needs are more important. How will you, you know, invert the triangle and start working again, right? So where, you know, these things are important and they don't, like, you know, a lot of people move back to their natives. Business continuity is happening, but we know that they are fearful. Some places where the connections are not a problem. How will you force them to operate or you know, to contribute, right? In such places, when I see, when the motivation level is down to a corner, you are talking to a very scared and very low person, how will you push him to the level of what he used to be and contribute? Now, this is, a lot of dynamics are being played. I see a lot of different, you know, innovations are happening in those terms also. And HR today, if I say, and I keep on telling many times that HR is like a mother. Now, the real mother factor is coming in, the care for the employee. This happened in the mid of the appraisals. People were very scared that would they even have a job, right? And many companies, they could not. Everyone is in a process of cash protection, you know, the cash flow protection, and many of us deferred, you know, the hikes and everything. Now you see the status, you know, entire year. If you go back and whatever we are taught and we, whatever in, we sell in HR in terms of performance. And how should we squeeze the bell curve, and what are the different mechanism, how we'll motivate the employee. Today, you don't give him hike, but still you want, half the year is gone by, you want the same, you know, or rather more contribution from him. So they don't work for peanuts. They only work that what, how much the company is caring for them, right? And that contribution, as I told that when I was in uniform, it was not that I was getting a salary, so I was working. It was for the uniform or for the association or for the stars which we used to carry for that, or maybe the person left or right to me used to work. Currently, I'm seeing that the people are working, contributing for the brand. If you would have created that sort of alignment with the employees, they are with you, they are not leaving you, and they are completely committed. If not, then all your, you know, management gig and all the jargons are not working out. And that's what. So I thought that I should touch on these small parts where I think how HR and the people aspect is working these days.
Wow, excellent.
I literally got goosebumps.
Yeah, yes.
That's so powerful and so meaningful when you're saying that it's the real. If you had a connect, you'll be able to bring take it ahead with this difficult time where. The theory that we talk about, that money is a hygiene factor but not the only thing that drives it. I think, yeah, a lot of those are getting tested when even difficult times, wherever people are able to stick and work and still do their best despite so not getting increments, or places where there are salary cuts, or suddenly places where they had somebody who was sitting next to them but is not there in the company. I think that's a powerful one. And I also believe on a similar context or analogy that Captain put across, that HR's role has been of, as the role of a mother has evolved, I think something similar to that. So and the interesting thing that I add to that, Captain, if you may allow, is while if you look at historical in Indian context, mother was supposed to only be the caretaker. Now they are also the inspiration to do the earn for the house and balance everything. So I think the role is also evolving. But I love that that context that you drew. But thank you so much for calling that out. That was interesting. Right. So what Captain, what is that one personal thing or one message that you would want individuals to focus on to deal with what's going to come ahead? And you've been in situation which has been in the field when everything was uncertain. The only thing you were certain about was yourself probably at that moment, but you've possibly dealt with that again and again and would have led a bunch of people into something like that. So What is that one thing you would want to tell every individual on this planet, this world, in terms of what they should focus on and how they should deal with the situation?
Many places I've gone, and I am quite in love with this word called resilience. So my thing is bouncing back, you know. That is something which is very close to me, and when you know we can connect, you know, with my previous life to this life, which is either you have it or you don't have it, and if you don't have it, then you have to make it. There is nowhere in your life if you cannot bounce back, you cannot face it. You know, you think that you know you will be sitting with the dog with the tail between the legs, and you think that you will survive. You will have to face it. When we opened the office, you know, I told you know my leadership team that every day I want all of you to be in the office. Now this is because we have to create that example from leading from the front. That yes, you know, if it is there first, we will create the example and people will follow, right? So there is no other options. You know, either it is a choice. You know, tomorrow if this is the end of it, you have a choice. Either you die fighting or you die, you know, just getting scared up. Right. So I will put very clearly resilience. You know, you have to fight back. This is what you have to keep it in the center. We have to be safe and everything is fine. But if it comes, and I have some examples where, you know, I have seen a few of the cases where the COVID has happened, and more the other things, like people are so scared and they get so frightened out of it, and different videos are available on the net too. But I have seen people going through it. Few of guys told me, boss, I never felt it. I had no symptoms. You know, I was completely fine. It was like any other day, running nose after when you have 2-3 glass of chilled beer and maybe you're not feeling that good. Yes. So it is like that. But if you carry yourself that I'll not talk about positivity, your attitude and all the thing. I will say, this is the situation we are in. Can you do something about it? I don't think so. At least you can frame your mind, you can program your mind to come out of it. You can see the situation. If you see the situation that tomorrow things will be fine, and you will be getting over it, as you know, it will drive you through. If not, then you will be completely, you know, sitting like that dog with a tail in between the legs and trying to see that, oh my God, tomorrow what will happen? They will sack me. They will be here. The company will be closing. The entire infrastructure will be going down. I don't know how it'll start. Shall I go back to my home? Shall I bring my parents? And, you know, unknowingly, knowingly, you know, you will have that dangerous hormone secretion, you know, and you know, the yes. Life will be over. You saw a few days back how people succumb to it, and it takes lives. It is dangerous. Yes. Rather, yes. Live with this. Feel that resilience, the fighter. We are born as warriors, right? And we will come out from it as a warrior. So that's how I keep it.
Wow. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't know what to say. It's definitely like watching a movie, Captain. Yes.
Thank you.
So, coming to the last question of this session now. There's a particular way culture has been defined historically. We've seen that. Now, do you think it is going to be, or is e-culture the future? Is e-culture going to be the new way culture is being would be defined as we go ahead?
This is a very a question which you're putting very early. I'll rather a lot of discussion I keep on seeing on that thing, and people are accepting it also. But you know me, Ketan, I am an old-fashioned guy. I still feel culture is what will be defined by people, and how it will be defined by the people. How do you make culture? You know, you have a society, you create heroes, you create stories about the heroes, you create festivities and associations around that hero, and the thing becomes a culture. Yeah, you remember our days, we have some gods and all the way we do it, and that's how it becomes a culture. I still feel that e-thing is will be a part of it. Of course, it connects thing and the technology, we cannot say it will be a supporter. Technology will be a crusader from here. But yes, that people connect, that examples, creating examples of the people, creating the examples of those guys whose leadership, you know, changed the entire mechanism of working. Whatever way, you know, you can today, the only those people will be coming in terms of the platform might change, but it will be driven by the people. Till the time human race will be surviving in this planet, the culture will be created by the people and their examples, how they conduct themselves in any scenario is what I feel. And rest everything will be platforms and you know, the connections and how it will reach to every employee or every person here.
Right.
Right.
Glad. Thank you. I think I love the simplest, one of the most simplest definition of culture that I've heard recently. But, that's very interesting. Okay, so the rapid fire questions, Captain. If you're ready, I am going to shoot at you.
Go ahead, all yours.
Okay, so next life, what would you want to? What would you choose, HR or the life in the army?
Rapid.
Army.
All right. Thank you. Cooking, cleaning, and mopping during COVID. Which one was the easiest?
Mopping.
Okay. What's your next big personal goal that you're chasing?
To repeat a full marathon again.
Wow.
Okay. And one thing that you would personally like to thank COVID for?
It has given a chance for all of us to internalize and think.
Wow. Yeah, pretty powerful as expected. Yes. I'm done from my side, guys. That was Captain Trano from Renault. Thank you so much for Captain. It was very interesting, direct, to the point. And I think I'm loving this combination of you saying the earlier life and the new life, which is the army life and the current life in corporate. But pretty interesting points. Picked up a lot of things. Senthil, over to you.
Yes, thanks a lot, Kedran. Yeah, thanks a lot, Kedran. Yes, thanks a lot, Captain. So the points were really, I was sitting there just enjoying, every point that you said. Seriously, when you spoke about how when people work for money, right? If an employer is offering like 100K, it's easy for the next employer to pay 110K and poach him, yeah. Right? But if the team, if they are working with the camaraderie, if you're working for a uniform, you're working for a purpose, right? Then that's something that is legendary. And this COVID has enabled that for all of us. And that was a great point. And when you elaborated on that, I was just enjoying. And of course, my favorite point that you said is about the resilience. I am a huge believer. I mean, I don't know if we can even talk about this for 30 minutes, that how you think, how you have framed your mind, that's that. You know, if you can really frame your mind, right now I'm in Chennai, so you're also in Chennai, right? So you know the situation is very bad. But if you're going to succumb to fear, if you're going to belittle yourself to, oh my God, this is going to affect all of our lives, then it's going to. But you have an option to, even on a thought level, fight this. Right. So and when you elaborated on that, I was in 700% agreement. And a lot of people are not like this. You know, a lot of people are right now not having this thought process. So I really enjoyed that. And of course, the many culture points that we touched also was phenomenal. So guys, this is today's episode. So we meet next week with a more points. And so thanks a lot, Captain, and thanks a lot, Ketan, for this session. And we stay in touch. There are many, many more points that we can talk about, Captain. Also, I will also connect offline if that's okay, and we can share values among each other.
Sure, Senthil.
All right.
It will be a pleasure.
Thank you, guys. Bye. Take care.
Bye-bye. Thank you.